o să mai stăm mult acum. Aici să începem deja cu prima prezentare. Și pentru asta îl invit alături de mine pe Richard de Graaf, care este Head of Human Resources la ING Bank România și care ne va vorbi despre noile programe lansate de ING pentru construirea planurilor de carieră a angajaților. Are o perspectivă foarte interesantă acolo. Și vom vorbi despre un... trecem de la Individual Development Plan la o platformă de My Learning și triunghiul Big Six. Abia aștept să aflu ce înseamnă asta. But I'll switch now into English. Richard, thank you for being here again with us in this conference. And thank you for sharing the wisdom. He took the HR, head of HR role for Romania in 2019, but he occupied similar roles in Italy and before also in several functions of ING. Hi again.
Thank you, Mihai. And thank you for inviting me again and having me back. So I've tried to listen to what you said, and I have to admit I did not understand a lot of it. Although I'm 1.5 year now in Romania, and I'm very happy here. So if you don't mind, I will continue in English.
Perfect.
I will share my screen, and I will just get into it because you only gave me 20 minutes, so I will have to speed up.
But I put my counter on, and it's
working. Yeah, I know. But I will try to do it even faster, so we have some time for Q&A.
No, but I like your synthesis as always.
And if there are any questions, just put them also in the chat, and then we can see how I can handle them.
We'll do that.
So let me start with sharing my screen. Let me see.
Just before Richard is doing that, I just want to throw the anchor there that you'll hear a very, very dear to my heart mindset in terms of career management. And I cannot wait to start that conversation. Richard.
But that will be at the end.
Yeah, of course. That's the hook.
That's the hook, yeah. Okay, so I hope you can all see my screen now, and then I can start with the first page, and that is the title page, the upskilling strategies in the fast changing digital world. And to start with, I think this is 1 year anniversary of working from home, and I just said I arrived here in September 2019, which basically means that 2/3 of my working time in Romania has been from this office you see around me, and that's sad. I mean, I prefer to see people around me. I think we are in HR, we like people, but it is what it is. And we show that we can do this. And it's very important to realize that we should not hide away, but this COVID-19 pandemic is a very, very big disruptor. I mean, our world is already changing fast. Our lives and businesses are disrupted constantly already by all kinds of factors and forces which are outside our control. And on top of that, we also had the COVID-19 pandemic. This meant for many of us that we had to speed up our digital transformation. We also had the opportunity to show that providing flexible working, work from home can be efficient. But for that, we do need a new way of working and using modern technologies. Imagine 1 year ago, a little bit over 1 year ago now, we would not be used to having all these webinars by Zoom or Teams or Skype or whatever we use. And now we are very used to it. Yesterday in ING Bank, we had a town hall and we did it all online. And normally we would all come together, but we are now in that rhythm. But it still means that our IT department last year had to work 24/7 to make sure everyone could work from home. So you see how important it is to have the digital interaction. But that also means that we may need different capabilities. And combining that, having these capabilities, but also making sure that our people start to grow, we need to start upscaling our people, increasing their internal mobility to make sure that we, as a bank, are able to serve our customers. And that is what we have been doing. And that is what we have been trying. That's not started last year, but it came in a fast track move because of this pandemic. And we have three different things we're looking at. Because the first thing is, we think that everyone at ING, and we don't only think it, we are convinced actually, has the potential to grow. And learning is happening continuously. But we also want people to take the lead. The people are their masters of their own career. I mean, you shape your own career. So take the lead. And we are here to provide you with learning. We want our people to keep the skills, their expertise up to date. And again, we will provide learning, training, just to make sure that we keep our competitive advantage in the market. And to be very honest, if you are able to do that as a company, we can build the talent that we require. So we have what we call great tools, and maybe it's not only tools, but it's also a mindset. And you know that I speak a lot about mindset as well, if you speak about the agile way of working. But what we have is the big six capabilities, and we refer to them in ING as big six. And some of you guys may be thinking like, hey, are they the big six animals? No, we refer to the big six capabilities. Then we have a platform, which we call My Learning, where we give the opportunity to the people to go there and to get all the learning opportunities they want and they need. And very important, we want everyone to have an individual development plan. And I will now go into a little bit more detail about all of these three tools. To start with the big six, and I'm very passionate about the big six. And I'm going to tease you a little bit. So the big six capabilities, why do we have them in ING? Because this is not only ING Romania, but this is ING globally. We want to deliver on our purpose. We want to deliver on our strategy to stay a step ahead in life and in business. We want to retain our competitive advantage, and we need to have the trust from our customers, regulators, and our employees, of course. It's not like you sit down in a weekend and you think like, this is our six capabilities. These are the capabilities where we say that helps on our strategy. That took quite some time. This started with the management board of ING Group. There were many, many sessions with corporate strategy. There were many, many visits to different countries, Silicon Valley, everywhere, to see what will be different in the future and what keeps us ready for the future. And here they come. What is, in our view, the big six capabilities, which we all gonna need? We have split the six into 2x3. So we have three distinctive capabilities that are the capabilities that help us stand out in the market. So that is customer experience, data fluency, and leadership. And we have our foundational capabilities. And that are the capabilities we need to get the basics right, to keep us safe. We are a bank, so we need to be safe and compliant. And we need to have the trust from our customers, regulators, and our people. And these six, and we're not expecting our employees to know everything in detail about them. But you can be an expert in one or two. But we want you to know the basics. So we want our employees to know the basics of each six. So and to give you a head start already. So I will now, in the next slide, I will show you a little bit what are the basics of the big six within ING. So if you ever come to work with us, you already have a head start. So the basics are customer experience. What do we want to achieve there? Of course, we want to deliver a differentiated customer experience. We need to have people in our bank who are customer-centric people, who are skilled in the use of new tools and approaches which allow us to offer great experiences at all skills, at all our customer interactions. And even if the role of the employee is not a direct customer-facing role, so you're not working in an office, you may be not working in a contact center, you may be even working in HR, it is still very important to know that you have a good understanding as an employee of our customers' needs and what are the latest customer experience tools and principles. So we want to have everyone the basics again. And of course, when you're working in a customer-facing job, then we want you to be an expert in it. The second one, where we say this will help us stand out in the market, is data fluency. data is extremely important. And I think no one will disagree with me where we say everyone wants to have more data quality, everyone wants to have more information. And what do we want to do with it? We want to be able to help our clients. We want to be able to help our customers so that we can draw insights from the data we have to improve their lives. And by anticipating their needs, we can make our offers much more relevant, much more personal, and much more convenient. And that's why we are asking for our employees to build the in-house skills to lead data, to understand data, and to explain data. We are not going to wait till there will be AI available for us. No, we will build it, and that's what we're doing. And that's what you will see also if you keep track of our vacancies, you see it's a lot related to data. And the third one is leadership. And leadership, you can say, okay, but we know that, Richard. I mean, everyone sees leadership, but we not always realize how often leadership and leadership skills have to change. And again, during last year, the change was extremely fast, by going from sitting next to your people by having to motivate them from a distance. But we need to make sure that our managers, our leaders are working continuously, making sure that they are sharp, they are relevant, and that they realize that it's not a one trick fits all. And it's not like, okay, I'm now a leader. I was promoted 10 years ago. I'm now in the board of a company, or I'm a people manager. And I got there because of my knowledge and capabilities. At that time, I don't have to do anything anymore. No, you need to continue. You need to continue. You need to change. Because in the end, it's not about you, but it's about the people you lead. So that are the distinctive capabilities. And then we go to the foundational capabilities. That's to, I will repeat, to help us to get the basics right, to keep us safe and to get the trust. And of course, we start with non-financial risk management. We are a gatekeeper to the financial system. We have a responsibility to protect our customers. We have a responsibility to protect the financial system and the society. So we have to make sure that we keep ING safe, secure, and compliant. That's our top priority. And integrity is what we say that's at the heart of our values and behaviors. So knowledge of non-financial risk management is extremely important. And the next one, cybersecurity. I think we all know all the stories. I think we all read the newspapers. We might even get some phishing mails or whatever. Cyber criminals continue to target financial institutions, including ING. They continue to try to get customer data. They continue to try to get access to systems. So we need to make sure that we understand how to reduce the risk of becoming a victim to cybercrime and how to respond to it. So we need to invest in cybersecurity knowledge, and we need to train the people in that. And that can be like very, very deep, or it can be like explaining people how a CEO fraud works. You have all heard, I think, once in a while that you get an email from your CEO, which is of course not the real email from your CEO, asking to make a certain amount, transfer a certain amount to a bank account. That's not how it works. So phishing mails, you know how it works. But we as a bank, we need to be on top of it. We need to understand what the cyber criminals are doing, and we need to understand how to fight them. Last but not least is operation management. And this is what we all recognize as well. We want our customers to have a great experience. We want it to be fast, safe, easy. We want to be effective and efficient, both for the customers, both for us. How we are doing it in ING, again, we try to be very, very fluent by using the agile way of working, by using the latest digital tools, and to be able to change and help the customer as much as we can. So basically, that are what we call the big six capabilities. And we think that with these six capabilities, if we have that all over the bank, we are future oriented, but also future prepared. And how do we train our people in this? And that's where we come to our new learning experience platform. So basically, we have a smart platform, and I will go through this quickly because this is a platform which we use internally. But we find it very important that people are able to find the learnings they need. So they have access to a lot of training, program resources to continuously learn and grow whenever they want and wherever they want. But the great thing about this one is that it's a kind of a smart platform. So they know the employee, they know where you're working, they know what you're doing. So the platform also suggests a learning content, which is relevant to the HR job. And of course, there is a lot of focus on the big six capabilities. If you look at our budget, our learning budget per year, 80 to 90% is spent on trainings for the big six capabilities, because that is our biggest investment. That is our biggest way to come one step ahead, or maybe two steps ahead. But the platform, MyLearning, who knows you, will suggest content. They will suggest where you want to go and what course you want to follow. And in the next two slides, I will show you some courses we have in the platform, because I want to spend a little bit more time on the part where Mihai is really interested in. So we have like future skills, agile design thinking, robotics, artificial intelligence, machine learning, PACE methodology, where you quickly can check will a new product work or not. Data fluency, I already told you how important it is for us. So we really, really want to stay up to date with our fast changing digital technologies. And the next one, and especially in this period of time, is the soft skills. Time management, stress management, emotional intelligence, I can mention all presentation skills. Actually, when I went into my learning this morning, and I don't know why, but it popped up for me a presentation, how to use storytelling in presentations. Like, I don't know whether they checked my agenda for today, but it was in there. I didn't have time to follow it, so I cannot do the storytelling now, but I think it's very interesting to see how the platform suggests some trainings to you. So I like that. And all these trainings and these big six capabilities, they all come together in what we call the individual development plan. And the individual development plan, it's really, really at the heart of the talent practice. And by saying talent practice, I'm probably not using the right word, because we are not saying only the talent should have an IDP. We are saying everyone in ING has the opportunity to grow, as I said before, and should have an individual development plan. And in that, we want to see the development needs, but also your career aspiration. And there are three parts of it. That's the plan for now, that's the plan for next, and that's the plan for beyond. And the plan for now, to start easy, that is, we look at your current job and what development actions do you need to perform better, to become more effective in your current job. And we can link that to the big six capabilities, and we can see what we can do to become even better in what we're doing now. The second step is the plan for next. So that is, what do you need to prepare for your next role in ING? Or maybe take more responsibilities in your current role. But this is where you need to be thinking like, okay, what do I want to do next? Do I want to be becoming an HR director in the HR management team of ING Group? Or do I prefer to stay in a country and in the business? That is where you start thinking about then. So that's the plan for next. And the third one, and that sounds scary for people, that's the plan for beyond. And the plan for beyond can be a new role in ING, but it's also possible to have a different role outside ING. And because at one point of time, you may plan to leave ING, and I prefer people not to leave ING, but I do understand that at one point of time, after 10 years, you may think like, hey, what else is there next to ING? And that's what we call the plan for beyond, because also there we want you to help. Because if you are starting today, or you're working 3 years with ING and you start now and you plan for now, you plan for next, and then you plan for beyond. I mean, we speak about a 7 years program. I will have very motivated employees. And if you find out that you like to coach, to become a coach, and I gave this example earlier to Mihai, so maybe if you're now working in HR and you want to become a coach, maybe the plan for next would be to become an HR coach. Because then the plan for beyond can be you become a coach, an executive coach, having your own company and your own clients. So we also support that. And that is the part where people initially, when you explain to them the plan for beyond, they look at you with big eyes and a bit scary, actually. Like, do you want me to leave ING? No, we don't want you to leave ING. However, we do find it very important that you are responsible for your own career. And if that means that at one point of time, your career is outside ING, we want you to help on that part as well. And trust me, it still may sound like they want people to leave ING. No, it's a very beneficial way for ING as well, because for the next 7 years, the people will work in ING on the plan and will be very motivated. So that are the three parts which we say has to be included in your individual development plan. And again, we are expecting everyone to have an individual development plan. It's difficult because we normally call it IDP. It's like IDP. Let's have a look at 2020, because I now said, okay, we ask people to plan for now, we ask people to plan for next, and we ask them for planning beyond. What does that mean? So how many internal movements do you have? And that's a right question. And I think it's the only right question. So we do encourage people to move around, because we do find it important that we retain our talents. And the people do appreciate the professional development, and they do like the challenges and the learning parts with internal job movements. And having the same people in your organization, but maybe moving from one area to another area, only helps with bringing in new perspective. So what did we do in 2020? We had, and remind you, we have 2,300 employees within ING Bank in Romania. So we had 566 employees who made a promotion, an upward move. That's around 20%. We had 80 people who made a horizontal or lateral move. So they are in one department and they went to another department. And there were 86 people who were at interim promotional role. So you see that we have around, 700 something people, around one third of our workforce, who made a move in 2020. And that is what we want to promote, because we want to have the knowledge in our bank. We want to have our talents in our bank. So we really want them to develop, to plan for now, to plan for next, and to be prepared for the beyond. I think this is the part where I will stop talking and will leave and go to the questions and answers.
Thank you, Richard. Thank you for this perspective. That's very important. I invite also Julia in as we're creating this community. I'll start because I particularly like this stance that you have with the beyond, as we have discussed, as we were launching career shift. And I like this perspective. Upskilling is also, about looking beyond, looking in the future, and acknowledging that, for some time, the role is here, and then you move beyond, But there is a crisis of meaning for a lot of people in this period, and they got close to themselves into 2020. And exactly by looking at their career and showing support as HR while they're there, I think that's a very transparent and a nice way to look at it. What were the reactions in your cases when, they made the big eyes, but then...
They made the big eyes. They are a bit scared. The one part I didn't mention, but it was on the slide. If I look at myself, we also encourage international assignments. So basically what I'm doing is that I sign a contract for 3 years, like I'm going 3 years to this country, 3 years to that country, and then it can be extended. So you are a bit unsure. However, if you are saying this is what I'm doing to be free later on, to be having all the experience, then I can continue to grow. And in the end, I think probably 95% of the companies still have the pyramid structure. So there are less positions at the top. And sometimes it's good then to either have the people realizing I'm at the top already and maybe I should do something else and give freedom and give the space to the people below to grow. Or people say, hey, maybe I can get another role and I've been prepared by ING to get another role somewhere else.
Mm-hmm. Just before passing out to Julia for the questions, and a nice thing that we also have in Humanistic, and I think it's a point worth mentioning, is that we've observed in terms of learning and upskilling last year, that actually the responsibility of the learning passes way more to the employee. And I'm looking at your plan in the ING. How is that, you're actually passing back the responsibility of the learning to the employee. And this will be a point that will kind of be made throughout the conference. In all this noise and all this busyness with the calls, that's hugely important in terms of upskilling.
Yeah, we really want the employee to take their own career in their own hands.
Yeah. Julia.
So what I've seen, Richard, is one, you have your personal development plan in ING. Two, you have at hand a platform you can search whatever you are trying to learn.
Yeah.
Three, there is a strategy with six, I would say, pillars or main capabilities, as you said. And then you have this way of looking on very long term. So it's, I think, because usually the development plans were just done on 1 year between performance appraisals, yeah, just to make sure that you maybe fill a gap, or you do your business and you are still on the market. And I really like this. In the end, it's a philosophy. I will just keep some questions that are coming here. One, the first one is, if you would have just a tiny budget as HR, would you have just a tiny budget from all these six, what would you prioritize? What would be the main capability that you would invest your money on?
that's a nice question. And I'm gonna give you a very boring answer. That depends on the person. I need people who have more experience on customer experience. I need people who have more experience on non-financial risk. In the end, we want everyone to have the basics. So probably if you were asked me, I would cut out the basic part, and I would just more look at the expertise part.
So I mean, that's our consulting answer. You know, it depends. Start with it depends. It's what we start.
I've been consulting for 15 years.
What's your favorite? Yeah, one can see that. So what's your favorite, though?
My favorite, I think, customer experience is my favorite.
Okay, cool.
And I will try to explain that. We do not realize in the bank sometimes how important our customers are and how difficult people who have a customer-facing job having a day-to-day life. If you would be in the contact center, in our contact center for one day, you would be like, wow. Because let's be honest, the reason why people contact the contact center is because they have a complaint. We're not getting calls to say like, you were great. We sometimes get it on Facebook or LinkedIn, but they're not calling us to that. So these people have to face that all the time. So one of my things is that I also want everyone in the bank to have that realization. And I also promote that people just spend a couple of hours next to a customer contact center employee just to learn how the customer experience is. So I will choose that one.
Thank you very much. You've shared at the end of the presentation some numbers with us, and I've seen something like over 500 people that took advantage of this internal mobility. When you're speaking about 500, it's 500 from what is the number of people that you are looking at?
2,300.
2,000.
Yeah, so 2,300. Yeah.
A quarter of them did that. That's very nice. Another question that is here on the chat and belongs to Elena is if you can tell us how was the attrition rate for you last year? It's just if you can share with us.
Low.
let me check.
I have it here. Let me check. 5.95%.
Mm-hmm.
That's one executive with a dashboard nearby, you know?
I like data as well.
Okay.
No, I say low because when I came here and people were telling me like, no, Richard, you have to get used. I mean, it's a high attrition, that's the market, etc. That's why I say it's low. I'm very happy with it, actually. I also do realize it had to do also with the pandemic.
So, okay. Yeah. Thank you. Elena, it's also saying thank you to you. Mihai has another question, and Mihai is asking, how do you support the identification of the future picture? Because there are some, and it's also for us, you know, if I would imagine myself in 5 or 10 years, it's very difficult for me to just imagine my next year. And how do you do something? Do you offer something? Is there some reflective tools or something that I can...
No, I come back again to the 6 capabilities because these will stay with us for the next years. And if you are an expert in one of these 6 capabilities, you will have a future because we really think that this is the game changer going forward. And let's be honest, they are not that special because you can all think about customer experience. You can all think of data. We see how important data is. Cybersecurity, I don't know the exact name, but I think it was a couple of months ago where the European Commission said that we're going to build a cybersecurity center here in Bucharest. That are the things, it will stay with us for the next years. So if you are an expert in one of those 6, I wouldn't worry at all, to be honest.
Yeah. Thank you. Just another short question, maybe the last one you can answer in the chat because don't really have a lot of time. But Elena has another question about the employee engagement part. If you noticed some change from 2019-2020, it was higher, lower. How was it?
It was higher. And again, there we are very proud about. And that's an interesting question because I'm very critical. And the people working with me know that. I like celebrating, but very often it's like, and now we go to do something next. So we measure engagement twice a year, and put it this way. And we saw in May, we measured, May 2020, we measured, and we saw it going up compared to 2019. And we said to each other like, okay, that's probably because of the pandemic, because people are happy with us, that they all work from home, we put them safe. And we went from 14% working from home to 95% working from home. So we thought we did a very good job on that part. So that's what the people think. So then the November check came and we were a bit scared. We were like, phew. I mean, the honeymoon is over. The honeymoon of working from home is over. So let's see what happened now. And the results were even a little bit better. So we're like, okay, we're doing something good. And then I was like, now I need to compare because I also have a head office and we have other countries and I have a boss in Amsterdam who then said, okay, yes, but maybe that is Romania. I said, let's have a look at the figures. Mm-hmm. And what we then found out, and that's the same actually with the attrition rate, that we saw everywhere an uptick. So everywhere we saw either the engagement rate going up or the attrition rates going down. Mm-hmm. But we saw that the differences in Romania were much bigger than the difference in other countries. So and there I said, okay, that's my proof point that we are doing the right thing here. Mm-hmm. Because it's not only the pandemic, but it's also the actions we are taking. So we are very happy that the engagement went up and considerably. And And then I will stop with bragging. So we do a McKinsey survey every year and or twice a year. And I can say we are in the top decile, so in the top 10% of the benchmark for all the McKinsey's companies they survey. And we are very proud of that. So yes, it went up. Now I will stop.
Thank you very much, Richard. Thank you for your very open answers and so transparent. As we would say, there are some other questions that I would invite you to.
I will go to the chat and
please do that just to make sure that we have answers. Time for all our speakers and guests. Thank you very much again. You're doing a great job. You are keep being innovative and having this very broad way of looking at a development of people. Thank you very much, Mihai.
Thank you, and thank you for having me.
Mihai, okay, what's next?
Again. So we're going straight to Romanian și vom trece la română din nou. Mulțumim, Richard, încă o dată. Thank you.